This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Book: Forbidden Fruit Anonymous. Preface: My readers of Forbidden Fruit may wish to know the origin of the work. It was this way. Whilst I was staying at an out-of-the-way village on the Sussex coast, I used to take long solitary walks, and several times saw a very beautiful girl sitting on a secluded part of the downs, attentively reading what looked like a manuscript in a black cover. Naturally, I concluded she was some very studious young lady trying to improve her leisure, as she did not appear anything like the frivolous novel about what she was so intent upon. One day, on the same footpath, I picked up what I believed to be her manuscript book, and looking curiously at the contents, was surprised to find it was a tale of the grossest kind, scenes of love and lust depicted in the most realistic manner, with prick, cunt, fuck, and other things mentioned in the plainest language. I sat down on the bank to enjoy this unexpected voluptuous treat, when suddenly I was startled by a breathless exclamation of, "That's my book! Oh, give it me back, sir. I must have dropped it as I passed along here a short time ago and ran back to find it. Your book, miss. I was just looking to see if there was any address in it, when I saw what it was about. Excuse my looking, it was done quite innocently and your secret is safe with me." Realizing at once the shame of the thing, she gasped for breath, flushed crimson, and then turning pale as death fell fainting at my feet before I could catch her in my arms. Reclining her against the mossy bank upon which I had been sitting, I rubbed and chafed her hands, squeezing her fingers quite painfully in order to bring her to herself, but for several minutes without success, as there was no chance to obtain either water or brandy in such a place. Presently she murmured, "Fuck me. Shove in into me. I want it all, I must have it now," and a succession of body expressions quite shocking from the lips of such a young girl, as she could not be more than 17 at most. It was incredible she could be so depraved, but it seemed a striking confirmation of what a doctor once told me, viz., that even the most virtuous girls often use frightfully obscene words when recovering from a fainting fit. Anyhow, I resolved not to take advantage of her and behave honorably to her. As she came round a little, she opened her eyes with the question, "Oh, where am I?" And catching sight of me holding her hand so tightly, all her shame returned to her in quite an overwhelming sense, and bursting into tears, she cried so bitterly it was a long time before I could reassure her. Promising to keep the secret of her book, I only asked one thing, and that was that she would not avoid me and allow me to see her again. This of course led to a close friendship between us. I lent her a variety of voluptuous books, and she let me have the manuscript to copy for my printer, but would not impart to me how she came by it, saying, "Some day perhaps after I am married, then I will let you fuck me and tell you all, it will not be long. My wedding is fixed to come off in 2 months' time. I'm a virgin and mean to be so till I have my husband, but have to thank your forbearance that dreadful day when you found my book and did not take advantage of the situation. I both respect and love you for it." She would permit me every familiarity, but the one thing. We frigged, sucked, and enjoyed every other pleasure, both abroad and in my own rooms, where she would visit me, having perfect liberty, living with an old nurse of hers, so not a soul in the place knew anything about either of us. When we parted it was, "Au revoir, and some day I may have more to tell." End of the preface. The author. How well I remember my early days, almost to babyhood, when it was always the care of my beautiful mother to bath me herself every day. There was also Mary, my nursemaid, but when Mama had to be away at any time, the supervision of my bath was delegated to her sister, Auntie Gertie, a pretty girl of 16 or 17. Till 6 or 7 years of age, I slept in a cot in my parents' own bedroom. Papa was a very dark, fine, handsome man. Mama equally so, or much more beautiful to me, had lovely golden hair and deep blue eyes full of love for me in every glance. I can just remember one day when Mary and Auntie Gertie were giving me my bath, I thought they were looking at my little spout, as I said saucily, "What are you looking at? Papa has got such a big one." Amongst the tricks I used to play on my nurse was one of suddenly running up to her and raising her skirts in fun. So one day when Mama was bathing me, I suddenly said, "Mama, dear, Mary has such a lot of hair at the bottom of her belly," making the poor girl blush crimson as she explained my tricks to Mama. Another time to Auntie Gertie, "You should see my papa hug my mama like a bear in bed." After this, my cot was removed to the nursery, as Master Percy was getting too observant. What romps I used to have with Mary! Then, when I was about 8 or 9 years old, I often would insist upon sleeping with her, always creeping inside her nightdress to nestle close to her soft, warm flesh. I would kiss her titties and pretend to be a little sucking pig, as I played with her belly even as low down as the hairy part, which she always resisted my handling by keeping her own hand over it. Often her motions were very curious. I fancied she was rubbing herself between her thighs, and she would finish with deep sighs and what seemed to me a tremulous shudder. Generally, she would also kiss me ardently. Time passed on, and I was growing quite a big boy. Somehow Mary and myself seemed instinctively to avoid ever mentioning our bedfellow games. As far as I was concerned, there seemed something too good to be told, even to Mama. I must have been nearly 12 when Mary had to go home for a few days to nurse her mother, so Auntie Gertie took her place in the nursery. She saw me to bed about 8 o'clock, and then went away, leaving me awake, wondering if she would let me get into her bed. By and by, I heard her enter the room, so pretending to be asleep, closed my eyes as she came to look at me with the lamp in her hand. "What a beautiful boy, if only I dared," I heard her say softly to herself. Then, placing the lamp on a table, she came again to the bedside and imprinted a warm kiss on my cheek, then another and another. Opening my eyes in apparent surprise, I threw my arms round her neck and gave her back kiss for kiss. This went on for quite a minute or two, till she said, laughing and blushing at the same time, "What a silly spoony boy you are, Percy. I thought you were asleep." "Oh no, Auntie Gertie, dear, I do love you so, and when you kissed me, I could not help paying you back. Don't you love me a little? Now go to sleep, there's a good boy. I must go to bed myself. Put your head under the clothes. If I catch you peeping at me, I'll whip your bottom, that's all," drawing the sheets up over my face. "Now keep like that till the light is out." If I could not see, my ears listened till I heard the well-known ripple of her water in the chamber pot, and out of shame, impudence whistled, the same as I had heard the groom do to Papa's horse when he wanted it to piss. Sudden darkness. The sound of that rushing stream electrified me. Sensations I had never experienced before coursed through my veins. My little pego hardened of its own accord, so jumping out of bed I exclaimed, "Auntie, I must give you a last kiss. How funny the noise of your pee-pee has made me feel. I am all of a tremble, just feel me." Winding my arms again round her neck, she seemed only too willing to return my eager kisses, drawing me to her bosom, till I could feel the firm palpitating orbs pressing against my breast. "Come into bed and cuddle me, Percy. I feel so chilly tonight," she whispered. Only too pleased, I nestled myself by her side, still kissing and calling her my loving auntie. Fate had ordained I was to lose my maidenhead that night, young as I was. Her hand passed all over me, caressing every part, and she freely abandoned her bosoms to my impassioned kisses. Presently her hand wandered down to where my stiff standing pintle was throbbing against her belly. Her hand closed upon my staff, which felt to me bigger and bigger every moment, and must even then have been a good 6 inches. Not a word passed between us. She glued her lips to mine, almost sucking my breath away, and altogether seemed in such an agitated state that I was nearly frightened. Still I felt only too pleased, as she held my affair in her hand and slowly passed her fingers up and down, drawing back the foreskin each time. Somehow she gradually worked me into a position between her legs as we lay side by side. Then she commenced rubbing the nose of my machine in a moist sort of chink, embowered in the silky hair at the bottom of her stomach. One of her arms hugged me round the waist, and presently a soft whisper murmured, Percy, push yourself close to me, it's so nice, my darling. I followed instructions, and hand-directing my instrument, it slipped in somewhere very moist and deliciously warm. She wriggled her bottom and drew me in more and more at each motion. Both her hands now pushed my bottom each time in response to her forward shoves. The game grew faster and faster. She rolled over on her back, her legs entwined over my buttocks, so as not lose the little prisoner she had got in her grot. Now, Percy, my love, shove in hard and fast, dear, make me come, isn't it delicious, my boy? Oh, Auntie, you dear Auntie Gertie, where am I going to? I ejaculated in a delirium of entrancing sensations. Ah, oh, what's going to happen? I'm bursting, and my head fell on her shoulder as I lay nearly lifeless, all the ecstatic emotions of the impulsive gushes throbbing from me, as her grot seemed to grip and suck every drop of my life, so as to mingle the very essence of our being in the recesses of what I now know was her womb. What a grip she kept on me! Something inside of her caressed the head of my instrument, and the contractions of that moist warm chink seemed to increase every moment. The folds of her adorable vagina worked up and down on my delighted pintle in a truly marvelous manner, and for the rest of my life I have never had experience of a woman so gifted as she was in that way. I was quite painfully stiff, she excited me so, and almost before I had realized all that had happened to me, the flood came again, and this time I could feel she was also gushing out love juice in response to mine. A kind of rage possessed me. I wanted to kill her by thrusting my instrument as savagely as possible, but the more I did so, the more vehement her motions became. She heaved up her bottom in desperate plunges to meet every thrust, and but for clinging very tightly round each other's waists, she must have thrown me off. Our mingled fluids spurted all over my bag of balls, and flooded our thighs at every push. At length we lay exhausted, but I was still on the top of her, and her vagina seemed as anxious to retain its working partner as before, but nature denied me the strength to go on. Oh, Auntie, you've killed me, it's gone dead now, as I felt it all limp and slipping away from her. Percy, dear darling boy, we must go to sleep now. Perhaps in the morning you will be all right again for another game. Only to think, I've taken your maidenhead, and what pleasure you have given me. Your father could not do it better. Has he ever put that big one of his into you there, Auntie? It must have hurt you awfully. Don't call me Auntie, call me Gertie. Say you love me, Percy, but never tell what we have done tonight. Your mama doesn't mind Papa poking me if she sees it done. We are sisters, you know, and they say it is all in the family, but Mama would be mad if she knew I had you first, so never say a word and she won't know. But I can tell you a secret, Percy. She means to have you herself when she thinks you are old enough, but she doesn't know what a boy you are, my pet. So let me have you to myself for a little. If you do too much, it will kill you. Mama and I almost kill Papa sometimes, we want such a lot of poking, but some nice wine soon gives him strength again. He took my maidenhead to please your mama, who thought she would like to see it done. Ah, that did hurt, his great big engine bursting into me and stretching poor Fanny till she was all torn and bleeding. Boys are not hurt like that. It is only the poor girls who suffer when they lose their maidenhead. Take my advice, Percy. Never let a girl or woman know you have ever been intimate with another. It is unkind to them, makes them jealous to think they are not the first. Besides, dear boy, you don't know how delightful it was to me to think I was the first you ever put into, and only a boy, but what a boy my darling Percy is, kissing me with all the abandon of her nature. We went to sleep, but our exertions so overcame us that we were late for breakfast and had not time for a game. Wait till night, we shall be all the better for the delay, she said, as we hurriedly dressed ourselves. All that day, my eyes were for my mother, and when she kissed me, my heart went out to her in a manner it had never done before. The loving grace in those deep blue eyes seemed to have a new meaning for me, and her hair looked more golden than ever. Was she ornamented with golden hair also at the bottom of her belly? I determined to ask Gertie about that. Auntie was 3 years younger than Mama, and rather slimmer in figure, but not anything so grand and adorable in my eyes. A feverish excitement pervaded my whole being, and frequently during that first eventful day when I already felt myself a man, thinking myself as good as Papa. My pego seemed to grow in importance, and raised its head, times out of number, as the thoughts of the possibility that someday I could be as free with Mama as I now was with Auntie. Dear Gertie could not help seeing how fascinated I was with Mama, and once even cautioned me to watch myself or all would be found out and I should be sent to a boarding school. She herself was very careful of me, and on the sly gave me a second glass of wine at luncheon, besides helping me to the most recuperative viands on the table. It was the same at dinner, and when at last she put me to bed at the usual time, I felt so rampageous, I made her look at my enormously distended affair. "How rude you are, Percy, tonight. How dare you, sir, show that thing to me? Now do your pee-pee at once and get into bed, or I shall whip you till your bottom is sore. Here is the chamber utensil. Let me see you do it properly, or goodness knows you will wet the bed like a baby, you are so distray." Her laughing face and the idea of a lady holding the utensil for me took away all power to micturate. I couldn't do it for the life of me. "Now go on, you bad boy, don't keep me waiting all night," she said severely. "Go away and leave off teasing me. You know I can't pee if you look at me." She put down the pot, and almost before I even guessed what she was at, turned me over on the bed face downwards, and began smacking my bottom with all her strength. Oh, how those spanks smarted, as she rained them on my devoted rump. "This is for your naughtiness, sir, will you obey me or not? Percy, is that rude thing always going to stick up and defy me like that?" Slap, 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 making me wince at every smack. "Oh, Auri, don't. Gertie, don't, that is not fun to me, you hurt me so." "Yes, and I hope I do hurt you, you bad boy. Will you do as I tell you or not? Why, I declare it's as still as impudent as ever," she said, thrusting her hand beneath me to feel how I was. "There, I must serve you out." "Auri, oh, you're biting me, Gertie. Oh, pray don't bite my bottom like that, or I shall scream." "I feel I must bite you, Percy, I can't make it be good. And there's only one way to make your instrument lay down, but you must wait till I come to bed, then I will see to it as I did last night." This little game, and the want of sufficient rest on the previous night, made me very sleepy, and when she was gone, I dropped off into a beautiful slumber, and was only awakened by her kissing me. Opening my eyes, there she stood by my bedside as naked as she was born, exposing all the beauties of her figure to my enraptured gaze. But what attracted me was not the sight of the ivory globes of her swelling breast, but lower down.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.